Another year's gone by. I'm so glad you're with me. The way you lift me up with the love you give me. It's good to know that you'll be mine when days are blue. Oh, what a dream come true.
Welcome to the Orange is the New Black podcast. This is season 3, episode 4, Finger in the Dyke. And I'm sure they're talking about the little Dutch boy here.
Yeah.
we're your hosts. I'm Rob.
Martha.
I'm Meg.
And Meg, do you have a description of this episode?
I do. Big Boo comes up with a scheme to make money. Daya, Tasty, and Crazy Eyes confront reality. And Caputo tries to make a good impression on some visitors.
That is, for an episode like this, that is the most simplistic.
Well, but it's actually so concise.
No,
that's it, everybody.
Works,
thanks for
but
listening.
But it's so funny because it's like, I mean, usually the descriptions are like, yeah, that's pretty dead on. This one, it's like, wow.
Freezes over a lot. Blame Netflix.
They did not really tap into that one. But, all right, who do you want to start with?
Well,
what storyline should we discuss? The tour? Or do you want to talk about Boo?
Let's get one out of the way.
Or Red?
Let's get that out of the way. Because
Red
I said right away, like, oh, don't make Red and Healy, like, become a thing. I think Healy's kind of falling in love, but please don't let Red fall for Healy and have that be a story.
I really don't like it either. And I don't like it in the same way that I don't like other things on this show. But I think it's funny. I think it's a little fun.
I mean, it's a little something, but
it's,
please.
It's no more than that. I don't think I can unsee it. So I need to not have that visual in my mind. Please don't make it a thing.
I don't think Red is interested.
I don't think she is.
I think that she's kind of curious, like, what in the heck is going on? It's because she said a nice thing.
Yeah.
I think she wants something. I think she likes the attention.
Yes. Oh, yeah. I could see that. And she's upset with her husband, but I don't think that she's looking
that
to hook up with Healy. But
that whole thing, like, if they set us up this way, okay, she's having marital trouble. She's not seeing her husband anymore. And now Healy's here. I'm like, no, don't do this.
I don't think so.
I just don't want that to happen.
I don't think so. And, you know, so he's trying to comfort her because she's mourning the fact that Nikki's gone. And then he brings her rose seeds. And then he acts like, oh, I don't even know what they are. You know, I just happened to pick them. I'm like, oh, dude, just own it, you know. But
I think he's going to get hurt because I really honestly think Red just wants something.
She doesn't want him.
That's no, not sure. him. She's got a different motive here.
Yeah. So there you go. All right. Well, that was easy.
Yeah. I wanted to get it out of the way.
How about Suzanne? You want to talk about Suzanne's storyline?
I felt so bad for Suzanne. She's cracking because of V.
Yeah. She's processing.
And the way that resolved.
That
I
was
just
so
felt
sweet, though, with her and Tasty.
Yes.
Because it really. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Okay. But wait. When she climbed into bed with Tasty, and Tasty wakes up and she goes, oh, too far?
Yeah.
I was like, oh, dear God, I died. I was like,
I like it because this is such a, it's a sad story at the end of the day because they both had this mother figure that they lost.
Yeah.
But then they just end the episode with her crawling into bed with her and it's like, oh, too far? It's too much? Okay, I got it. Noted.
And I love how she gets it when someone tells her it's too, and she's like, okay. Boundary laid, got it, you know, peeing on your floor or whatever she did to Piper back in season 1, you know, like, oh, okay, that's inappropriate. Okay, got it.
Yeah. Got it.
You know, she hasn't done that since, so she does grow.
I like how Tasty's keeping her in check.
I do, too.
I like how they're sticking up for her because they understand her and they all had a big blow with this. I don't think the other girls understand her as much. I don't know if it's just because Tasty's her bunkmate.
Poussé is not understanding at all.
Suzanne right now.
And I think Poussé's going through her own stuff as well.
Yeah. But I loved that they had a good cry over it.
And, yeah, I think they needed that.
Tasty finally got to have her little breakdown, you know, and admit that it was that she lost somebody.
The V's gone, too.
Even though
because up to this point, she's like,
her.
V's coming back.
Right.
How about when she was having the nightmare and she looked like a dog?
Oh,
she was
my
like
goodness.
Scratching at the air. She's like, oh, there's a dragon coming. Oh, V, get away.
I just like how then she's like, you need to go back to bed. And they go back to bed on their metal frames.
Yeah.
And then the next morning she wakes up and she's perfectly fine. All the girls are like, are you serious right now?
She pops up like, la, 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 had the best night of my life. What's going on? Why do you look so tired? You know?
And I like how just the little details in this scene about how the girls sleep and just, you just see so much. The little things to me in this show are priceless. Yeah. Some of their legs are up on the wall. Just like, and everybody's tired. And then Suzanne just jumps right up and is like, yep, all right, time to start the day. And everyone's like, oh my God. Mm-hmm. Oh, I love it.
Well, there was that little bit of, it reminded me of Meatballs at the beginning when they did wake up and you heard, I can't think of her name, not O'Neill. Is that her name?
No, his wife?
Yeah.
Belle.
You hear Belle's voice and she's like, it's another glorious day at Litchfield Prison. Everybody up. Remember that with Meatballs when Bill Murray every day, it's the camp. Everybody up.
Yeah.
Just cracking me up.
Or Good Morning Vietnam.
Yeah.
No. Because it's not a camp. That's a radio show.
Whatever. It was
Good
same
Morning
thing.
Vietnam.
Seemed like
it's still a really strong introduction.
See? Thank you, Meg, for defending my stupidity.
That's also because I've only seen that one movie that we're talking about.
All you have to do is hear the title and go, the Good Morning Vietnam. Clearly, Rob, that's what they were intending. It was
you've never seen Meatballs?
No.
Meg.
It's an 80s
classic
camp movie.
It's a classic.
All right, I'll put it on the list.
It's Bill Murray.
Yeah, it's Bill Murray being Bill Murray. It's so
funny.
In the
80s.
Yes.
Yeah.
This podcast will be us talking about Orange is New Black and me making a list of all the stuff you guys need me to see. Just put it on the list.
All right, let's talk about, how about So-So when she has Meadow come to visit her.
Yeah.
I love it. She's
grown
up.
Here is a huge growth for
and
So-So.
What a tool Meadow is.
Yes, and what a tool So-So used to be.
She's never been to prison. Meadow's just enjoying her life. And that's exactly what Brooke would be if she wasn't in prison.
Yes.
And Brooke's just getting this hard reality. And I don't think she's going to have a huge breakdown like some of the other people are seeming to be going towards. Mm. But I think she's going to crack a little bit and be like, "This my life was a joke. And this is reality."
Right.
And I'm really enjoying her.
Yes.
Her story this season just because she was very childish and annoying last season.
Well, and a little bit of So-So in this case can go a long way.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
They're
yes.
using just little bits.
Yes.
We're getting a little story, and I'm enjoying that. I
yeah.
think if we had if the episode was focused on So-So,
we would be having a different conversation.
Yeah, it wouldn't be
right
like
now.
We talked
yeah.
about Nikki last time.
Yeah.
You know?
I think what would be really good for this character is if we had a little bit of her each episode, and then in season 4 we got her story.
That
because
work.
I think by then we will have enjoyed her enough, a little bit at a time. It's kind of like how we see other characters, like, I can't think of her name, but the track star. We saw her story. We
yes.
saw her. She's got some great one-liners, and that's all we really need.
Right.
With So-So, it's the same thing. We're seeing her evolution, and we can see her backstory one day. But beyond that, there's not much there unless this character takes a turn and becomes one of everybody.
Yeah.
Because in the drama scene last episode, she still was annoying.
Oh my
She's like,
gosh,
this isn't
yeah.
how this is supposed to be.
Right.
But I think with each episode, we're chipping away at that a little bit.
Well, and I think that she had a mirror put up to herself.
She did, yes.
With Meadow. And it was all of a sudden, oh my gosh, that was me. That
yeah.
was how I was when I got here. And now I've seen the world. Like, this is and then when she threw it back at her and she was like, you know, my life is miserable and this is not something to, this isn't fun. And it's not something, I thought this was cool and this is not cool. I'm stupid, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
So, yeah, I thought that was a really important scene.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's really good that they're showing her growth like that. And
You're kind of drifting off there. What are you doing? You falling asleep?
I'm taking a nap.
All right.
There's not much more to say about it.
So,
you got
okay.
It.
So, it was, you know, clearly we had visitor day. Gloria had her son there who's freaking out of control.
Oh my gosh. I like how the woman's like, he's a serial killer.
And then what does Gloria say? She goes, I will get my brothers to come and they will dangle you upside down.
Yeah, over the bridge.
Over a bridge till you pee yourself and it goes in your mouth. Like, I was sitting there going, oh my God, what kind of mother?
Yeah, right.
You know?
I think that kid needed that kind of level of extreme. Like, I don't think, is that her mother or
I don't know
sister who's wanted. Raising?
Yeah.
So whoever's like raising her sister. Kids, yeah, has tried the normal punishments of this with this child, and I think it took Gloria as the mother being like, listen, you don't snap back into shape, this is what's going to happen to you. And I think it sunk into his head. I just don't think it's gonna, she's not there with them every night, so I don't think it's gonna sink in right away.
It's not gonna work because the woman
even scared me, and I'm not, she's fictional,
right?
But the mother or the woman even said, like, okay, genius, so who's gonna get him here every week?
Because Gloria said, you have to bring him here you have to come here every week with your homework. And then the woman goes, who's getting him here? I can't get him here every week. You know, so if there
I
isn't.
I think Gloria will find a way.
I don't know.
I don't know about that. I think that's why she was depressed through the rest of the episode, because she realized
I can't
parent this kid.
Yes. I think what they've been doing that a lot this season with that one woman who had the baby taken away.
Well, that's why the first episode was called Mother's Day, and I think they were.
Yeah, I think that's what the overall.
This is the mother season.
This is a season of where that's really the focus. And when
I think
talking
this is
about
just the season of like relationships.
I think
of
it's
just
their theme.
In the theme of this is just figuring out these people that are, nobody's really new. Everybody's already been in their life. And it's just kind of figuring out people in your life and how to manage that while in prison.
But I think it's specifically mothers, because when you look at, at the, think of every episode, all the flashbacks have been about the child and their mom, and the kids are getting taken away. And we're seeing like, why would they show Gloria's teenage son? It never worked in any other season. Daya having the baby and who's going to be the mother? Who's going to take care of it? Now all of a sudden Pornstash's mom is here. I think that is the overarching theme, is sort of what
and
prison
even when you think
does
about
and,
it.
And what our relationships with our mom, how it defines who we are and how we end up.
Yeah. And if you think about it, like, Suzanne and Tacy lost V, who
they
was
lost
very much
their
a
mom.
Mother. Alex
Nikki.
Yeah, and Nikki's talking about her mom and how that,
and
like, that's coming into play.
Yeah.
And then even Alex in the first episode, I believe, was saying that her mom would be so disappointed in her right now. Yeah.
Poussey and her mom.
Yeah,
and
I think it's everybody just learning and just figuring that out.
Yeah, and Nikki and Red's relationship, you know, and she's like, you're my mom. I will always be your mom, you know? And it's like, she's like, no, I wouldn't wish that on you. You know,
right.
I think that Doggett and her mom.
Even Healy and his mom.
Healy
we saw
and
that
his
scene.
Mom. So I think that's the theme. I think we figured it out. That's what it is. So here we have Piper and her family come for her birthday.
Yes.
And wow, that was hard. That was really hard to watch. And
as
is
we
Cal
speak,
different? Is it a different actor?
As we speak,
no,
I have I have an auction going to get a wearable bass drum.
Oh my God!
We're talking right now.
I love Cal. I just thought he looked so different, but
no,
maybe
I think
it was
it's the same
me.
Guy. I think it's that he had the mustache and the hair is what it was.
This scene, I love Cal. I love his wife. I think they're making the best out of everything. Of course, as somebody who loves this type of discussion on television, I think Piper's more realistic than she has been ever before. Just like when her mom asks her. If that means, since she has a girlfriend, if she's going to declare what she is, and Piper's like, no, it just means I have a girlfriend. It's so realistic for her. I love her more than anything in the season for that conversation, as annoying as she was in the past seasons. We needed her to be annoying, because it's not – she had a fling with some girls and then had Larry.
Yeah.
And she doesn't know what she is, and that's normal. That's so realistic. Mm-hmm. And it's society and us that want her to say, what are you?
Put a label
and
on it, yeah.
In prison, she doesn't need a label. I mean, nobody really has a label. They're just surviving. And I think it's so comforting for her to finally accept that.
Yeah.
With that said, I think it was, for me personally, it was pushed a little too far when she was making certain noises for her parents.
Okay, that, yeah, yes. You know what?
I was like, oh, no, Piper, I was on board with you, and then you said that, and now I'm getting, it's creepy, I'm getting chills from it.
And you know what it does is it really cheapened her message.
Yes.
And if she had just been mature about it and just said, you know what, this is what it means. And, you know, I understand that she was reverting back to being like an eighth grader because she was mad at her dad for his comments. Yeah. And she's mad, you know, her mother is a, you know, her mother. And, you know, and I think that she was just doing a typical, you know, I'm just going to be an eighth grader right now. But I think for the show, I think for humanity, it was really a disappointment because it really cheapened her, the impact.
It did.
That
it was very out of place of what was going on, yeah, too.
Well, I saw it as I liked what she said, and it was out of place. I didn't feel... There's a comfort when watching this show that everything's going to be the same steady, amazing delivery.
Yeah.
And I don't think it was exactly that in this moment. However, I didn't see it as out of character for her. Mm-hmm. I think she's a very... I think one of her flaws, as everybody has flaws, is to be this immature, selfish person.
Yeah.
And I think that was just one of... Maybe it is a new writer, maybe it's not. But I think that was just one of Piper's way of saying, like... putting her middle finger up to her dad instead of actually doing that. It was this and getting just the one last punch in before she knew he was going to leave, and she didn't really care. I don't think Piper cares a lot this season
about
what other people think about her.
Yeah, and that is refreshing. I'm glad that
it's refreshing.
Yeah.
However, it was uncomfortable. I think it was meant to be uncomfortable. I could have gone without it.
Yes.
But it wasn't exactly... so overboard that I was like, this is terrible.
Yeah.
I didn't think it was that way. Mm-hmm. However, I could have gone without it.
Yeah, I didn't like it just because it was so uncomfortable. And also I was kind of like, oh, you had it, you know, like you nailed it.
Yeah, you had
and
it.
Then and then you had to ruin it, you know, like,
I also
oh,
don't
why?
Think she wanted, I don't think she wanted to sit with her family after that.
She wanted,
she wanted them out. So and I love when she, because if we think back in season one, when her grandmother says, so you're a lesbian now, and Cal says something, I can't remember what Cal said, but then when she says that she has a girlfriend and Cal looks to his wife and says, well, I saw that one coming.
Right.
It kills me every time. His comments are the best. Yeah. I love Cal.
Yeah. I do too.
And the fact that he's preparing to be an ice cream vendor with futuristic titles, like, man.
Oh my gosh.
He's great.
Oh, he's fantastic. And then she asks Alex to be her girlfriend. I loved that scene. I thought that was very sweet. When Alex...
I mean, it killed me.
Had made her she couldn't make her a mixtape, so she made her a list of the songs that would have been on a mixtape. I thought that was hysterical.
I tweeted out and I said, you know, somebody out there is making that mixtape for their girlfriend as we speak. We know it.
Yeah.
But yeah, it killed
me.
Meg
was
I'm such a fan
mixtape.
Of theirs.
You were making that mixtape for yourself that you're going to be...
I definitely paused it this morning and went and looked up all of the songs.
Alex made this for me.
It's
oh,
mine.
That's awesome.
Oh no, I didn't. I kept one of them. It was Tegan's there, but it was just, I'm just their number one fan.
I love
I'm so happy about them, but at the same time, I don't know. They feel more natural now, and I'm good with it. I'm just gonna think positive.
We're gonna just sit in this moment, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was really good.
All right, let's talk about Boo.
Yep.
Yeah?
Okay, so first
you wanna
of all,
start?
I want to talk about the backstory because...
Carrie.
As soon as we saw her as a little girl, I was like, we're getting the Boo backstory. The kid had the eyes. The kid was Boo. This is
Mini
great.
Boo, yeah.
And I loved how the dad was with Carrie.
At
Once
first.
Again, it
not
was,
at the well, end.
Not at the end. But how well, he was with her, how... We saw how the mother, once again, mother's story, how we saw the mother really shaped elements of Carrie.
Well, I think the dad has always supported and accepted her. I think the dad at the very end of the episode was grieving for his dying wife.
Yes.
Yeah, that was
and
about
was,
the wife.
Yeah, I don't think he purposely was saying, listen, your life is a lie. I think he was saying, your mother is dying and... I don't know what to do about that.
I agree.
And you're going to hurt her.
And you're going to hurt her. Yeah.
And I don't. Yeah. And you've left us. Because she said, he goes, we haven't seen you in ever, you know. And she's like, yeah, I'm 42 years old now. And I still am struggling. And it's like.
Yeah. And it seemed like he was close with her. So this, he's probably got a lot of baggage about her at this point.
I think so. And you can definitely tell that he knew. How I think he knew how she identified from when she was a young child, probably before she did.
Yes.
But I strongly believe that it takes two to tango, and everybody needs to do their part. And I think he did, the mom did not do hers.
No.
I think he accepted her, and I think it was just hard for Boo. And it's if you think about it, it was a different time for Boo. It was a different time for all of them. And I think it was just, at the end of the day, you could see that inside her heart, she felt sad by the end of the episode that she didn't go back and talk to
absolutely,
her.
Absolutely. Yeah. And when she, you know, and she had to wear the dress to picture day. And her dad is like, it's one day out of the year.
Yeah.
And, you know, and it's like, yeah, I hear you.
I'm hearing
that,
both of them,
But at the same time, what is it freaking, why does her, how she looks to her friends and whatever overrule who I am? Like, so if I asked her to dress like me one day a year, do you think she'd do it?
Yeah, right.
Yeah, exactly.
So I have a really hard time with that sort of, just let her have her way on this. And it's like, but you're not asking her to, you know, just eat this meal because I'm not going to make you a new one, or you know, or just just be nice to this person for a minute.
You're saying
completely change who you are.
And if you think about it, picture day now is completely different. But picture day when Boo was growing up, this picture was going to be in a frame on a mantle, passed around to her family. This was a picture that they would get. And this was the picture of the year. She was probably not going to go out and get more. Like, this was how she was going to be remembered that year.
Yes.
And I think that's exactly what her mother was thinking. And that's exactly what Boo was thinking.
And that's why I'm saying, her dad was saying it as, it's one time, just put the freaking dress on.
Yeah.
And it's like, it's not one time. You are saying, this is my identity for the next entire year.
Right.
And this is how you're presenting me to the world. And it's not who I am.
Exactly.
And so, yeah, that was very, very powerful. And I don't think that it was as innocuous as it was, they were trying to make her think
and
it was.
With this overarching story of Boo, I think the disapproval of her identity and her expression is supposed to seem absurd to us. We're supposed to say, why is everybody hating on her?
Right.
Just let her be who she was. And the way that it's written, the way that we see this, and as an audience, all audiences watching this, we see that everybody in her life, not everybody, but most people in her life are just disapproving.
Yes.
And by us seeing that it's strange that they're doing it, it's in change, making it normal.
Right.
Making her identity normal in this society, in this world.
Right, right.
And we take it away from it saying, oh, well, if I think that's strange, then like strange that they're disapproving, then in real life, I won't disapprove.
Right.
And that's kind of just how I was seeing it, that it was hard to watch her be hurt. And it was hard to watch her go through this, but it was meant to be hard.
Yes. And I think that throughout her, they showed, you know, certain interpersonal, relational, you know, like sort of moments, you know, and she screwed up every single one because she has this chip on her shoulder and she allows it to color every part of her life that could have been good. And, you know, but that's how everybody has, you know, we all have our,
well, she's got anger issues that come bubbling up fast.
Yes,
of course. And I think with this character, some of the things she says were warranted and some of the things she says were right. However, she takes it 10 steps too far.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas that little boy, when that said something, that boy shouldn't have said anything. However, she took it way too far.
Yeah.
Way too far. And it made it uncomfortable
and weird. Made it uncomfortable for everybody.
And it ruined her chance with that girl.
Exactly. And I think I it's hard to say because me, I'm just the type of person that would have kept walking. Kept walking and let him go.
Yeah.
It wouldn't have bothered
because
me.
Because it's not about her. It's not about him. And it's about who he is and why he feels the need
to
hurt someone else over something that had nothing to do with him.
And that little kid just completely affected the rest of her night.
Yes.
So it was just, I think that's just her character though, that she takes it a couple steps too far. But we also see, even in comparison, Boo that's in prison now is not as angry, is very understanding. And she's having this wonderful relationship with Pensatucky now.
Oh my gosh, I love them.
I love it. And it's going so, I've seen so many articles about this show and it's not the relationship. At the very end, when Pensatucky says, if that's who you are, that's who you are. And you might as well embrace it. Talk about character development.
Well, and that you know what? I even wrote, because what we were talking about before about the theme, I wrote on my notes, Boo has become Doggett's mom. And I put a smiley face. So even there, we're seeing it. And she's teaching her how to brush her teeth. She's and teaching Doggett her how to care for herself. That was my favorite scene from the show episode.
I have porcelain teeth. I don't need to brush them anymore. I was like, really
oh my goodness.
And then Boo goes, your parents didn't even do the bare minimum with you, did they? Oh my God, I died. You know?
I just love this character development between both of them. And it's going a little bit unnoticed. And I just want to be like, look at this. Fantastic. Look at what we've got in front of us. It's fantastic.
The chemistry is just brilliant. Oh, and I love that it's not made sexual. Like, it is truly just them developing this sort of...
Boo is one of the characters that understands the lines boundaries clearly.
And,
she knows Pensatucky's not into that. She doesn't even go anywhere near that. Like, with Nikki would have tried. Like, hey, well, you know what? I'm going to take a shot here.
Yeah. And that's why I really enjoy that this was written with these two characters. Mm-hmm. I was talking about this.
And you would never expect the two.
Exactly. No. And I was talking about this with another a friend of mine, and I was saying, you know, there's a lot of strange relationships this season that we would have never have imagined, but they're so great.
Yeah.
And this is one of them. And I think it's my number one where it's unexpected relationships and friendships.
Yes.
And it's Boo and Pensatucky. And
absolutely.
I love it. And
I love it so much.
Yeah. This season, it feels so much more like one big community. And whereas before we had them very separated into whatever groups was that episode or that season, right now everybody's meshing with everybody and it's great.
Yeah. And I loved when Sophie gives Boo the
Sophia.
Boo the makeover.
Yes.
Oh my gosh, I was dying. And she goes, I look like my mother, you know, but I was like, no, you always look like your dad.
Well, I like how everyone's complimenting her, like, oh my gosh, it looks so great. Pensatucky's like, nope,
you look
that
weird.
Doesn't look like you.
Yeah.
Just get rid of it.
Yeah.
And I think it's just Boo played the game and she likes playing games, but at the end of the day, when she's not true to herself, she doesn't like it. And that's what the freak out was over this guy. She should have never brought him in, but they were having fun with this guy who was in Pensatucky's circle and they were just having fun with it. But at the end of the day, she's not true to herself and she didn't like it.
You mean the Reverend?
Oh,
yes.
Awful. Oh my gosh.
He was awful. And it was great because when she freaked out at him. And that's what I'm saying. Like, it was a fun and game.
Yeah. And I thought it was so funny when she was, like, you know, seeking out money to help her on her spiritual journey. Oh, please.
Right.
But when she met up with the tour, Caputo's tour, and she's in her outfit, which that's what they did it for.
Yeah. And she
walks up and she goes, a big hetero hello. And then she goes... Did you buy it? You know, like, did I pass? Oh my gosh, no. Oh, it was so funny. It's like
the best part about this tour was some of the ladies really tried, like in the kitchen, they tried.
They did.
But then, and the other girls were like, this is just part of the day. And it's like, do I look hetero enough? Like that, that was just, that she didn't care if there was a tour or not.
Yeah.
It was great. And speaking of the tour, when Piper says if she's going to try really hard with her lady brain, I was dying.
Yes.
And I wasn't laughing until the one lady on the tour started laughing.
Right. Yes. Right.
That was awesome. Oh my gosh. That was when Big Cindy. Oh, she's my favorite. I love her so much. She cracked
she's
up.
She's great.
But when she met the tour and she goes, white people. And then she goes, white people and other. Oh my god, I was on the floor. I was dying.
Amazing.
Oh my gosh.
And then Suzanne starts like taking off her clothes and walking
by. And she's talking to a mop, and then Morello's crying.
I didn't even recognize.
Oh my gosh.
Can you imagine being Caputo, like, really, guys, of all days? Yeah. Can we just pull it together for 2 hours?
Yeah, exactly.
And then the guard, like, to try to make an excuse, he's like,
Ford.
Yeah, he's like, well, their circles are all synced up. I was like, guy, go walk away.
That was Kowalski, I think it was one of them,
but it was so funny.
My reaction to that was like, you tried, bud. It couldn't get worse, so you tried.
And they're all just standing there with that
he's
look.
He's like, we just have to deal with them for 2 days.
Yeah. And one of the guys was like, makes sense.
Oh my goodness.
It's great. It's just so funny.
So funny. I
can't get over Suzanne talking to a mop, Morello crying, but somebody asking if she's hetero enough. Oh my goodness.
Even the inmates, though, the two girls that work in the kitchen, the one turned to the other and go, do you have your period? She goes, yeah. She goes, oh, that makes sense. Yeah, it was so funny.
It's really funny.
So what else is in this episode? Did we get it all?
Daya interrupts the tour because she wants to know where Bennett is. And now we're really seeing...
Oh, yeah.
Now
Bennett actually missing.
It has been 2 weeks.
Yeah.
I kept thinking in the other episode, I'm like, oh, it's probably only been a couple days. He's just off or he's just...
And Meg, like you said about Nikki, like Nikki's gone. Bennett could be gone.
Yeah.
Because
he could be gone. I don't know.
It doesn't seem true to his character.
But Caputo's like, yeah, but it might be.
It doesn't seem true to his character. And that's the only reason I'm holding on to the suspicion that he's doing something for them.
I agree.
He's doing something to make this easier on them. And if that's getting a new job, moving, I don't know. Yeah. But I think he had a wake-up call of, I have a kid, and this kid's coming into the world, and Dia wants to give it to Pornstash's mother, and Dia's mom wants to give it to that same person, or
Cesar,
and the guy has a gun on a teenager.
Yeah, right,
I think he's just having this wake-up call of, I need to step up and do something, and I think that's where he is.
I am hoping for the best of the character, but I'm not sure. I mean,
I'm not putting all my money on it. Yeah.
I don't mind him gone.
I don't mind him gone either. For Daya's sake, he should come back. But for my sake as a viewer, I don't mind him gone.
I don't like his character. So I think if he
comes back with a saving grace kind of, I think I'd like to see what it was. I'd be more interested.
Yeah. And I think he and Daya are annoying. So whenever they're on together, I'm just like, oh, please hurry. Please hurry.
Yes.
But, yeah, so I've been liking these two episodes with him missing, but I think we find out that Litchfield is back in business. They're now going to be owned by the federal government.
Yeah, that was right at the end.
So that'll be interesting to see how that turns out.
There was a line that dropped in here that I wonder about when Caputo was getting the message about them getting taken over, that the Fed is going to take over. The guy said, when they had looked at the shoe and everything, there was all this space available. So what does that mean?
They didn't
look
at the shoe. They were at Max.
At Max. Right, right.
Yeah.
But there's
space
available.
That's a huge difference.
So what are they going to do?
They're talking about a whole other prison.
Are they going to take Max and fill it with other prisoners? Are they going to up this? Is it going to become co-ed? What are they thinking of doing with it? If they're looking at that and thinking, it's just like retail. If you've got space and you're going, okay, we make X amount of dollars per square foot.
Which is how Nikki's coming back.
Right. Okay. Oh, we lost Meg. Okay. You know what? Let's wrap it up.
Okay.
All right? So thank you for listening, everybody. We'll get her thoughts on that on the next episode. You can find our past episodes at our website, which is www.southgatemediagroup.com. And just click on the link for Orange is the New Black podcast, and you'll go to the page that has our bios, and it has past episodes and everything else on it. You can follow us on Twitter. Follow Martha at SMG Pods. Follow me at R Southgate. And you can follow Meg at MEGGH11. And that's where we all tweet from. And I think that's about it. Find us on iTunes. Find us on Stitcher. Find us on wherever you find your podcast. We should be there. And please rate us, review us, follow us on Facebook, join our email list. If you go to our website, you can join the email list. We need followers there. We want people to find out about this show. That's it. Until next time, thanks for listening, everybody.